If you would, please stand and turn to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Today we're going to talk about Christian persecution, just what you wanted to come to church to hear about. Today is my 40th wedding anniversary. Happy anniversary, sweetheart. I love you. How she did it, I'll never know. All right, so we'll read, we're going to go through verses 3 to 10, but we'll read verses 3 to 8 to begin. So Paul's writing to the Thessalonians, and he says, "We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is fitting, because your faith grows exceedingly, and the love of every one of you all abounds toward each other, so that we ourselves boast of you among the churches of God for your patience and faith in all your persecutions and tribulations that you endure, which is manifest evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you also suffer, since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you, and to give you who are troubled rest with us, when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. Lord, there's so much in these verses, and I know the Thessalonians were going through difficulty. I know that there are believers in other parts of the world going through great suffering and difficulty, and we lift them up to you and ask that you would sustain them. We pray, Lord, today that our hearts would be open to what you're speaking to us and to help us, Lord, as we find a way to approach the culture that we live in here in America. We ask, Lord, that you would strengthen us, that you would help us, Lord, to be able to endure as these Thessalonians did, and as the culture becomes more hostile towards Christianity, Lord, that you just fill us with your Spirit and enable us to continue to be lights and witnesses for Jesus Christ out in society, in the culture, in the places where we go. So we ask, Lord, today that our hearts would be open to you, that our lives would be open to your Spirit, and that you would not only speak to us, Lord, but enable and empower us to be what you want us to be as we leave here today. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please say hello to someone as you get seated. So as we observe the global conditions, obviously, we are living in uncertain times. But those things that we see occurring around the globe and in our own country need to happen in order to further what we read is going to happen in the Bible. I mean, you know, the good thing about the Bible is true. The bad thing about the Bible is true, right? So, look, ultimately, like we were singing today, at the end, there's victory, and we have an eternity to look forward to. But in the meantime, it's a little different. Now, as the Thessalonians suffered persecution from the cultural aggression that was against them, so in our own country, the tide of persecution is rising, and globally, we see it even more in other countries that are not able to resist some of the pressures that they put on Christians in different areas of the world. Now, the world is governed by Satan. He is the god of this world, right? Little g, 2 Corinthians 4:4. And he is not friendly to Christ, so obviously he is not going to be friendly in his work to those who follow Christ and represent him. So here Paul provides us a perspective on persecution, no matter what the source is that it comes from, because it can come from different areas. And Paul gives thanks for these Thessalonian Christians in verse 3 to begin the exhortation. In verse 3 he says, "We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is fitting, because your faith grows exceedingly and the love of every one of you all abounds toward each other." Especially in difficult times, it's so important for the brethren's love to abound toward each other. But unfortunately, in our own country, we have a divided church. And there are churches that will hold that biblical line. They will hold to the Word of God. They'll share the Word of God. They'll preach the gospel. And there are those other churches that are entering into the unbiblical arena of the woke culture, and they're praising a lot of the cultural directives that are actually hostile to the Bible. They're against the Word of God. Now, history tells us that in the past, and we should all know this, the countries that fell to both Marxist governments, which is essentially communist, and the Nazi regime, they had churches that stood on each side. They had churches that stood for the Word of God, and they suffered persecution under those governments. While there were other churches that joined those cultural movements, they praised the wickedness that the governments imposed on the society, but they just became nothing but a government, part of the government propaganda machine that was there. And the government essentially took them over, and it was not a church, essentially. Now, these Thessalonians suffered under their own countrymen, we learn from 1 Thessalonians 2:14, and that's typically where it comes from. Most oppression upon Christians historically, and as we look around the globe, comes from some of the cultural society or people's countrymen, the people that live around them, and oftentimes the government does not protect them, and at times even becomes part of the persecution itself. But Paul boasted of these Thessalonians' faith in their suffering. So in verse 4 he says, "So that we ourselves," he's talking about his ministry team, "boast of you among the churches of God for your patience and faith in all your persecutions and tribulations that you endure." Now, his boasting would encourage the other churches to hold the line of the truth and to continue to share the gospel. They were patiently enduring their persecutions for Christ and to maintain their testimony. So much so that in 1 Thessalonians, when he initially wrote to them, in verse 6 of chapter 1, he says, "You became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction." So they were harassed from the beginning. He said, "with joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became examples to all in Macedonia and Achaia who believe. For from you the word of the Lord was sounded forth, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith towards God has gone out so that we do not need to say anything." I mean, this little church in Thessalonica was having a tremendous effect, not only in the area, but even beyond, so that Paul and his ministry team, as they went around to the other areas in Europe and Asia Minor, could boast of what God was doing through these people in Thessalonica. Now, persecution obviously is not uncommon against Christians. It's not something new. I mean, in other parts of the world, our fellow Christians live in some areas in constant threat against their lives. And it's becoming a growing practice, and we should remember them in prayer. Again, in 1 Thessalonians 3:4, Paul said, "We told you before when we were with you that we should suffer tribulation just as it happened." In other words, Paul was not preaching a gospel where he was saying, look, if you come to Jesus, everything's going to be rosy. Everything would occur that you want to occur. Reality changes. It's all blessing and it's comfort from here on. It's actually the opposite. Look, God does bless. God does provide comfort. He provides rest within the external tribulation. We need to find rest in Christ. And this is what many believers around the world have to do. They don't have an option because their living conditions are not comfortable. For example, in North Korea last month, a two-year-old, a toddler, was sentenced to life in prison after the parents were caught with a Bible and taken into custody. A little different than where we live. Bibles are considered contraband in North Korea, and as many as 70,000 Christians and other religious minorities are in prison camps in North Korea. It's not something you hear on the news much. There's different pressures and persecutions around the world that our brothers and sisters suffer. Again, last month, there were 6 Libyans that were arrested, and they faced the death penalty for converting to Christianity. This is after 2 American school teachers were accused of being missionaries inviting Muslim Libyans to convert to Christianity. So they were detained and deported to Tunisia. So you see, I mean, we could go through Iran. We could go through Nigeria, Sudan, Afghanistan with that horrible withdrawal, and it left thousands of Christians that are just being hunted down by the Taliban and killed because they have no more protection. If we just look north in Canada, there are cities in Canada, I believe Montreal is one of them, where it is illegal to preach the gospel. You cannot preach about Jesus. There's Calvary Chapel up there that some years back asked for prayer because they were being restricted in their ministry. And just last year, January 8th, right, 2022, they put out a conversion therapy ban. So essentially, if you were a pastor, like I probably could not talk about the things that I will talk about today if I was in Canada because I would be violating the law and arrested. And, you can't talk to somebody from the LGBTQ+ community and try to share the gospel because essentially that is trying to change them. You can't convert them. They see that as a conversion therapy. And there are pastors that are fighting it because they're afraid that even in a normal one-on-one, non-public conversation, if you share the gospel with somebody, then they can then go to the government and say, hey, they were trying to convert me and make me something that I don't want to be. But this is the global trend. During his keynote speech in Orlando last month, Franklin Graham addressed challenges facing the Christian media, and he offered advice to those concerned about religious persecution in our own country. He said, if you're not going to preach the gospel, you don't have anything to worry about. If you're going to talk about sin, you're going to have, if you're not going to talk about sin, you're not going to have anything to worry about. But if you're going to proclaim the gospel, they're going to try to shut you up. Preach the gospel, he said. Use your radio, television, blogs, internet to communicate the gospel. There's Holy Spirit-filled power in the gospel. When you try to tell a person they're a sinner, it's offensive. When you tell somebody that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and there is no other way to heaven or God except through him, you offend people. The problem with cultural Christianity, he added, is that people place too much emphasis on offending people. The gospel in and of itself is offensive, but that doesn't mean we need to water it down. Preach. Don't back up. Don't make excuses. Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel. Don't apologize for the gospel. Just declare it. Just preach it. I appreciate him. You know, he's one of the voices that stands up and he gets a lot of flack for it. But what he's saying is true. If you're going to preach the gospel, you're going to get harassed. You're going to get pressure. You're going to try to get shut down. And, you know, in war, when you receive the most fire, you know you're over the target. And when you're preaching the gospel properly and you're getting the fire from the culture and even potentially from the government, then you know you're over the target. Now, as we try to live the morality of the gospel and the truth of the Word of God, problems arise. In our own country, as of May 2nd, there have been at least 85 attacks on pregnancy resource centers and 152 attacks on Catholic churches since last May. So that's basically over the past year. Many buildings were vandalized with threats that said, if abortions aren't safe, neither are you. And these are from pro-abortion violence groups. The extremist group Jane's Revenge has taken credit for many of these vandalisms and attacks. So it's not just what people are saying. Sometimes they actually take an action against Christians and things that Christians are trying to do to help people and protect life. Where is our government on it? Well, as in the news recently, I'm sure some of you know, there were leaked documents that reveal the FBI was actually targeting Roman Catholics. So they're not just preventing persecution, they're actually the fueling source in many areas. And you can bet, if the Roman Catholic churches are being infiltrated by FBI agents trying to find those dangerous Roman Catholics, then Protestant churches are certainly on their radar. I mean, the FBI does not see these denominational barriers as a problem. Have you ever wondered why it is that the government and the culture seem to cling so insatiably to desire to destroy children's and unborn babies' lives? It's almost an addictive, insatiable drive. It's like they can't live without it. Last year, the Department of Justice Civil Rights Division charged 26 pro-life individuals with the FACE Act. That's the Freedom of Access to Clinic Entrances. They charge them with those violations. So basically, you have people protesting or standing across the street because they can't get in front of the place, and then they're offering an alternative to girls that are pregnant that are going to go in and have an abortion. They offer an alternative to not have an abortion, to explain that you have other options. One of these guys was Mark Houck. He's a Roman Catholic father of seven. He was arrested by the FBI at gunpoint at his home in front of his children. So think about that. So you get a guy that's demonstrating against abortion. I mean, certainly we have to have, you know, the FBI SWAT teams come out and get this guy in the middle of the night. I mean, why aren't they doing this to dangerous domestic terror groups? That's a good question. But the answer is because Christian morality is more dangerous than violent drug gangs or foreign nationals on the terror watch list that are crossing the border. That is how there's aspects of our own government, that's how they view Christian morality. What other reason would they be doing this? I mean, the administration, the current administration, wants to kill babies up to to and even beyond the time of birth, and states are passing laws to represent this abomination. It's insanity, and it is diabolical. There's a few states. I think it's Maryland, Colorado. I know California is trying to pass it. There's another state I can't think of. They not only want to have abortion up until the very moment a baby is born, but they want to add 28 days afterwards for the parent to decide whether they want the child to stay alive. This is insanity. This is murder. This is pre-planned, cold-blooded murder. And look, this is a wickedness that I don't even know how to describe. I mean, in Nazi Germany, 12 million Jews, Jehovah's Witnesses, Gypsies, and handicapped people were systematically murdered by Adolf Hitler. Abortion obviously has killed many, many millions more. But it's still a systematic murder of human beings. Now, why am I giving you this rundown this morning on these issues? Because these are moral issues that affect Christians in our country. They may not be affecting us right now, but there are areas of the country that they are being affected. And don't be confused. I'm not talking about politics. This is a talk about morality. These are the morals that we live by and hold dear. It has nothing to do with politics, nothing to do with political party, okay? This has to do with morality and our ability to live out the gospel. It's illegal to have an opinion against many of the immoral abominations that our government right now enforces. Gender reassignment surgery that permanently mutilates children is another sick abomination that's promoted and protected. Well, the Bible teaches parents to protect their children, not to mutilate them, not to ruin their whole future. I mean, the suicide rate among these trans kids is 20%. So one out of every five kids is going to attempt or will be successful in committing suicide. Their depression rate goes up afterwards. It ought to tell you something. But then you have to ask, why are their policies not only protecting but promoting it? What's behind it? The Department of Justice labeled dozens of parents as terrorist threats. In other words, because they don't want their kids being taught a lot of this stuff in public schools where around the country they are. One example involves the FBI investigating whether a mom was a threat to her local school board because she belonged to a right-wing mums group known as Mums for Liberty and because she's a gun owner. I got that right off of the House Judiciary website page. Look, when parents can't have a say in their own kids' lives, who they are, what they're taught, that's a moral issue. The Bible gives parents a directive over their children, and they're responsible for the oversight of their children's development. The problem is to have an opinion against any of these draws the wrath of the culture and possibly legal action from the government, like with abortions, right? In other words, free speech is being just taken away. People are fired because of what they think. They don't even have to say anything. Just because of the thought police are after them. So as Americans, all the freedoms that our founding fathers and patriots shed their blood for is just eroding away. It's very sad to watch. But as Christians, we're in the crosshairs of the wicked and corrupt moral agenda that is occurring in our own country. And if you want to see where we're going, just look around the rest of the world because it will eventually travel here. Our culture will have no peace with Christian values. Biblical values are not tolerated any longer, and their mere existence is like a call to action against Christians and Christian groups. It's really crazy. You know, I mean, out of all the different groups in the country, you get Christians that are trying to love and protect people, be kind to them, be good neighbors, right? Share the truth, help out, work at volunteer centers, and it's like, oh, these are the real dangerous people. I can't remember the last time I saw a Christian commit some actual terrorist act. That's not how the gospel works. So, as with the Thessalonians, so to us, Paul says this in verse 5. In moving from verse 4 to verse 5, where he says about their enduring faith and patience in persecutions and tribulation, verse 5, which is manifest evidence, the Old King James says token there, it means evidence, of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy, not made worthy, but counted worthy, just like your righteousness is accounted based on your faith. You are counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you also suffer. So the suffering of the Thessalonians was really a proof of the coming judgment. Jesus said, these things I've spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Right, John 16:33. So the wicked don't suffer and get their due now. In this temporary world, the righteous suffer. It's frustrating, I know, but there's a future judgment that must come because God is righteous and his justice will ultimately prevail. Now, the evidence here that Paul is talking about, when God judges the wicked that don't come to Christ, when he returns to set up his kingdom, Jesus is going to bring the wicked into judgment. The ones that are alive at that point, and then at the end of the millennial reign, all the wicked in hell and the people from the tribulation period, the beast, the Antichrist, they're all going to be up before Jesus at the white throne judgment. And part of what he will judge them, it talks about he's going to judge them according to their deeds. Well, part of their deeds, the evidence against them, is what they did to God's people in this world now. So for the last 2,000 years, the records are all kept. God knows who has done what. I mean, think about the persecutions and the martyrdom in the past. That's all on God's ledger. And he's going to make it all right in the end. The exhortation today is whether Christians suffer physically or not, the important thing is that we need to endure. This means that believers are to stand their ground when others are fleeing. We're to hold out when others are giving in. And we're to remain steadfast no matter what anybody else does. It doesn't matter what anybody else does. We need to keep the course. The Thessalonians endured suffering for the kingdom's sake. And again, the world is run by Satan, so he's at war with God. But because he can't get God, he gets God's representatives, and that's us. So we're at moral odds with the culture and any anti-government, anti-biblical government policies that will be against us. In other words, whether it's the government, whether it's the culture, they try to pressure us legally and socially to obey things that are contrary to the Word of God. Like Peter says, you know, we ought to obey God rather than men. We need to stick with the truth of the Word of God. And as Franklin Graham said, the gospel is offensive. It's always going to be that way. It's never going to be non-offensive. And the gospel is the message that we have for the culture. That's the only thing that we can provide to the unsaved. It's not like you can give them a Bible study because they don't know what you're saying. They don't have the Holy Spirit, so it's not like they're going to understand the truth. Until a person comes to Jesus Christ, through the conviction of the Holy Spirit and the power of the gospel message, they will not understand what you're saying. God has to then give them life when they come to faith in Christ, and then it'll make sense because they have the author of the Bible living in them. Other than that, you know, Paul says it's foolishness to them. They don't know. The world then accepts and tolerates and makes excuses for other religions, but not for people that follow Christ, right? And this is because the conviction of the Holy Spirit accompanies the preaching of the gospel. And this kind of unseen activity where the Holy Spirit is convicting people of the truth is not happening in other religious systems, other religions of the world. Other religions are designed to comfort people in their sin or play on their self-righteousness. And so they have a system, no matter where you look in the world, they contribute to their own salvation. They work for it. They get to different levels to attain it. They can feel good about all their contributions and everything else. When Christianity is the opposite. In Christianity, a Savior came because men are hopelessly lost without Him. And I mean men and women. I guess you got to be specific today, right? In other words, people can't save themselves. There's no possibility. People are lost. And so Jesus came to save us. And the first time He came for salvation, that's what He did when He paid His life on the cross. And when He returns the second time to set up His kingdom, He's going to judge the living and the dead, Paul talks about. And then the eternal punishment is what the lost get, and eternal blessing is what the saved get. It's a simple process, but it has to be worked out. So, look, we are saved by God's grace, you know that, but we reveal our worthiness to be part of His coming kingdom by our endurance and suffering for Christ's sake in the world right now. So, we don't earn our salvation, but we are rewarded for our service to a place in His kingdom. That's why Jesus gives you the different parables on, you know, there's a guy given so many talents and different amounts of money, and what did they do with them? Did they bury it in the ground? Did they do nothing with it? You know, and that's not talents like a skill set. That's in the parable, the talents are money. But the idea is that everybody has been given something by God. Everybody has a gift. Everybody has a sphere they live in. Everybody has an ability. God has gifted all of you differently. And you're all different people. And so what you do with what God gives you in this life, He will reward you for later. Even though He's the one working and enabling you to use those particular gifts and strengths that He's gifted you with, He rewards you for your efforts. Not for the success of it. I mean, you can't determine the success. You can only determine whether you will yield your lives over to Christ so that God can do through you what He wants to glorify Himself in this world right now. We don't get any other chances. You know, in the latest book I wrote, in the front, you know, when you write books, you always put like a little quote in the front of it. Because it's one of those things that kind of identifies where your perspective is as you're kind of coming to the book. And I put this quote in front of it from Norm Geisler. He said, "Everyone in heaven will be fully blessed, but not everyone will be equally blessed. Every believer's cup will be full and running over, but not everyone's cup will be the same size. We determine in time," talking about now, "what our capacity for appreciating God will be in eternity. By our temporal obedience, we determine our reward in eternity." And he references 2 Corinthians 5:10. So, we have an eternal future waiting for us. I mean, if this is all we had in this world, we'd be in big trouble. Even Paul said, if only in this life, you know, we had hope. In 1 Corinthians 15, he said, we'd be, of, especially the apostles of all men, most miserable. Here we are, we're preaching about a resurrection, he says, and eternal life and life from the dead and a future kingdom and everything. And if it's all not real, he says, we're not only wasting our time, but we're living this self-deluded life. We're talking about something that's never going to happen, and we're suffering for it. Like, what would be the benefit? It'd be crazy. But in verse 6 to 8, in the meantime, before we get to that eternal future, he says, since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you, and then he has a little parenthesis at the beginning of verse 7, he says, and to give you who are troubled rest with us. And then he says, when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God. Now, this is through general revelation, which is creation and conscience. They don't know God through general revelation. They haven't recognized him as the true God. And on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, that is special revelation, the Bible. In other words, they've heard the gospel and they've rejected it. It's two different groups. So this is not a reference. His return is not a reference here to the rapture. This is encouragement that God is going to avenge his enemies. And so after the tribulation period, the seven-year tribulation, Christ is going to come, and he's going to repay with tribulation those who trouble the Thessalonians, right, verse 6, and really all believers through the centuries. Now, evil is currently allowed to run its course, but it has an expiration date, and it's coming. When Jesus returns at that time, all believers will have rest. Rest, the word rest means relief, release, and being out from under pressure. In other words, it's the opposite of tribulation. And that's because the persecution that will extend through the end of the seven-year tribulation will end at the second coming of Christ to judge the world. So what Paul is saying to these Thessalonians, and it would be really to all Christians, they shared in his suffering, and they're going to also share in the eternal rest that will be offered at that time. So the kingdom is going to be established, right, verse 7 and 8, when? When the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God. So Paul's specific in the timing of the punishment of the wicked, right? So in verse 9 and 10, he says, these shall be punished with everlasting destruction, not annihilation, it's everlasting, from the presence of the Lord, in other words, from the place of his light and blessing, and from the glory of his power. When? Verse 10. When he comes in that day to be glorified in his saints and to be admired among those who believe because our testimony among you was believed. In other words, because they believed the gospel and came from darkness to light, and we're part of the kingdom of God, when Jesus sets up his kingdom, they're going to be all part of it. They're going to be part of it because they receive the truth of the gospel. So Paul ties the persecution of these Thessalonians really to the time of Christ's return. In other words, none of the Christians that face persecution, whether it's the Thessalonians or throughout the centuries, whatever oppressions or martyrdoms or anything that, it's none of it is forgotten by God. All will give an account for what they did to God's people, everybody. But the current general global persecution by oppressive governments, we need to realize, is preparation for the coming government of the Antichrist. It's stage setting, which Paul gets into more in 2 Thessalonians 2. We need to realize that the Antichrist can't just step up and take over. There has to be a plot. I mean, things have to be developed. So we're looking at the banks, they want to move away from cash to all electronic currency. Well, we've known that for 2,000 years because in the book of Revelation, the Antichrist economic system is set up so that if you don't bow to him, you can't buy or sell. In other words, you can't do business. Well, how would he control that? He can't control that if everybody's trading nickels and dimes and dollars. You can only control it electronically. I mean, think of what somebody can do. Again, you know, up in Canada, when the truckers had their strike during COVID because they didn't want to take a vaccine. This isn't a vaccine, positive or negative. It's not what I'm talking about. But the basic problem was they striked, and so the government identified them as a domestic terrorist group because they were striking against it. They didn't want to have to fall under that mandate in Canada. So there was some lady that owned a donut shop or something, and she contributed $50 to their, you know, their efforts or whatever. So the government basically locked her bank account, shut her down. She couldn't get access to her money, and her business went. She went out of business because she gave $50. I mean, this is the type of control that the government can have over you when you can't trade in cash money. When everything is electronic, it's all accessible by somebody else. But that has to happen in order for the Antichrist system to be set up. I mean, let's face it, it's a genius system. You know, no more drug cartels handling, you know, cash or anything like that. You can control everything. People don't do what you want, you shut them down in 2 seconds. Can't get food, can't get health care, can't get anything. No heat. No air conditioning, no electricity, no running water. Just shut them all down. People will comply. You bet they will. But this is all stage setting. It has to be set up in that way. And why do you think the culture, not just in our country but globally, why do you think they believe such insane, crazy things? I mean, how can a person be confused, really, as to, like, what they are? So we look at this stuff and we say, like, what has happened to people that they can't think logically enough for normal, basic, reasonable truths? But again, you know, you get into the education system fuels this nonsense, it becomes political, drives the social culture, and then eventually you have people that can't think straight. When you have a whole global culture that can't really think straight and they think up is down and down is up and everything else, well, you can easily manipulate those people, and that is part of the setup of the Antichrist kingdom. He will be allowed to reign for a few years. It's a short time, but it has to come to fruition, and then Jesus will return and set up his kingdom. He'll put all the governments down. Could you imagine if he returned today, went to the UN and said, okay, here I am. You think they're going to just say, oh, finally, he arrived. Here, you can have our country to rule over it. I don't think so. They try to kill him again. So he has to, for 7 years, kind of pry Satan's fingers off the world and then return in judgment and to establish his kingdom. So in the meantime, how do we live as Christians? Peter tells us how to live and to speak. In 1 Peter 3:14 to 16, he says, but even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And then he quotes Isaiah 8:12. He says, and do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. That's the first thing. Sanctify means to separate. God has to be separated in your heart first, your relationship with him and who he is in your life. And he says, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. Now, this is very difficult when your rights are assaulted and you are not doing anything wrong. It's very frustrating. I mean, look, it's frustrating just to be blamed for something you didn't do, never mind to have your rights removed for something that you're not doing. But we need to remember we are Christians before we are Americans. I'm a member of the kingdom of God, right? Paul says our citizenship is in heaven when he wrote to the Philippians. I have a seat in heaven. I'm not from this world. I'm not an alien, but I'm just saying, you know, I mean, after this message, some of you probably think I'm an alien, but this is not our home. I mean, look, we have been blessed to live in the greatest country in the world. However, even this country eventually will have to come under the global system. Now, I pray to God that it gets delayed in our country. I do. But you know, you can't stop the ball from rolling, but it can be slowed down. But it's going to happen. It's already written. So we need to remember that, look, I was in the military. I love the country. I will stand up for American values. You know, I bleed the color of the flag. But we are still Christians first. In other words, our morality and our identification is from heaven first, from the United States second. And we need to remember there's a priority there. But sometimes God allows Christians to go through difficulty because that's the only opportunity they'll have to give their defense for the gospel to the people who they're put in front of. But the point is, don't let the culture shut you up. But if you speak, like Peter says, let it be a defense to everyone who asks you for a reason, the hope that's within you, right? Standing for morality is living out the gospel. So don't let the world shame you into silence. You know, in the book of Acts, the word boldness literally means freedom of speech. It doesn't mean that somebody else has given you the freedom of speech. It says, and when they were filled with the Holy Spirit, you know, they had boldness because the Holy Spirit opens up your heart, and when you start talking, He gives you the words that you can freely speak to share the truth of the gospel with others. That's what you're seeing in the book of Acts. Now, when Paul wrote to the Corinthians, in 2 Corinthians 10, he said, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Hey, if you're out in the culture and somebody says something against God, I mean, look, I'm not telling you to stick your nose in other people's business and create problems, but don't be afraid to stand up for Christ. Don't be afraid to say, well, that's not true, or why would you believe something like that? You know, I mean, we don't want to be hostile. I mean, we want to be kind. Peter says do it with meekness and fear. So we want to be able to come across in a way, you know, that is gentle, but at the same time, you know, not be kind of shamed into just shutting up because people will make fun of us. Because today it's just being made fun of. Tomorrow it's being locked up. There's a progression with it. The only truth the world will ever hear is from you. Because the government's not going to tell them the truth. The educational institutions are not going to tell them the truth. You get the truth from the Bible. Paul says in Ephesians that the church is the pillar and ground of the truth. The church dispenses the word of God, the ones that do. That is where the truth comes from. It doesn't come from any other source. It's not going to just kind of float out of the sky. And the only people that are going to tell it is us. We're the only way that the culture is going to hear it. And we have our marching orders from the Bible. Right? So prior to the rapture, we just have to remember that that this is not our home. We're strangers and pilgrims, and we're in a temporary place. We're ambassadors to a foreign country, but eventually the Lord, we sang it today, He'll take us home. So that's our marching order as Christians. If you are not a Christian today, worship team can come up. If you don't know Jesus, you can escape the eternal death that's coming upon the wicked. The gospel, which is very simple, that Jesus died for our sins according to the scriptures, was buried for 3 days, and rose after that according to the scriptures, was seen by witnesses, and He did all that. He died on the cross to pay for our sins so that you would never have to suffer an eternity apart from Him. He paid for our sins. He was our substitute. And the gospel offers sinners like you and me an opportunity to be forgiven and to be part of God's eternal kingdom and to enter into God's plan for your life. Though we're not deserving of it, and His mercy enables it, it makes it all possible because of what Christ has done. And all God wants from you is your faith in Jesus Christ. It's by the merit of Christ that we gain heaven, and it's by grace alone. We are entirely undeserving. But the faith or the trust, same thing, that God wants from you, it has to be yours. He leaves the decision up to you, and He's not going to make the decision for you. The reason that He leaves that decision up to you is because He gives you the opportunity to love Him or to hate Him. And I'll leave you with this line that C.S. Lewis says in his book, The Great Divorce. He says, "There are only two kinds of people in the end. Those who say to God, 'Thy will be done,' and those to whom God says in the end, 'Thy will be done.' All that are in hell choose it. Without that self-choice, there could be no hell. No soul that seriously and constantly desires joy," and he's referring to God's presence, "will ever miss it. Those who seek, find. Those who knock, it is opened." And so, God offers you an opportunity to be forgiven, not because you deserve to be, but because Jesus did all the work and paid all the price. So if you want to give your life to Jesus this morning, if you don't know Him, as Matt plays, you can come up front. I'll pray with you. We'll give you a Bible, and then you can remember it's my anniversary that you came to Christ.